Board of Mayor and Alderman, thank you, Mr. Stuckey, for correcting me so everybody can hear me. For those that are watching on television, it looks like a different night. We may call this the baptism of fire tonight. Sure, we have four new aldermen. We're excited about the elections, and the people have decided to serve in our community. And so they're sitting around the table as aldermen-elect, and in a little while, we'll have them sworn in, and we'll be having committee assignments. So we wanted them to sit on this work session because these are things they're going to be seeing. So the next item on the agenda is for me to call the roll. And so I've got Alderman Barnhill.
Here.
Alderman Blanton.
Here. Sorry, oh, green
thank
button.
Thank you. Alderman Hansen.
Here.
Alderman Peterson.
Here.
Alderman Berger.
Here.
Alderman Brown.
Here.
Alderman Potts.
Here.
Alderman Baggett.
Here.
And Alderman Martin.
Here.
Good.
Here.
Good. Thank you. Delayed response. You know, electronics not what they used to be. Next is the opportunity for citizens to make comments for items that are not on the agenda. And tonight I have one speaker, and that's Jill Bergen, who is from the Heritage Foundation, that wanted to make a brief introduction. So welcome, Jill.
The Heritage Foundation of Williamson County, and really we just wanted to congratulate the new aldermen and welcome you to this process. And our whole staff is they're dedicated to help you in any way if y'all have questions. As you know, we produce the three signature festivals in downtown Franklin. We also own and operate the Franklin Theater and manage the Downtown Franklin Association, Merchants Association. And we really appreciate y'all for your efforts in the throughout the campaign process and your willingness to step forward really and serve this community. So congratulations. We appreciate the outgoing aldermen, and we appreciate y'all for doing this. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Jill. One other item that I have, which is not a citizen comment, is my comment, but Representative Whitson called me earlier today, and he left all the aldermen a Tennessee state flag that's flown over the Capitol, and the new alderman-elect, he's left one of these legislative books. I forgot what you call them. So. Yeah, the yellow one used to be the blue book, and there was a really great year when it was orange. So item number one is event permit for Christmas parade sponsored by the Kiwanis Club of Franklin on December the 4th in downtown Franklin. Anybody got any questions about that one?
Just want to note that the parade is back, and we're excited to see that happen. It's a big event. Kiwanis are excited to have it back, and the parade steps off at 2 p.m. on December 4th.
And next is event permit for Dickens of a Christmas by the Heritage Foundation on December the 11th and 12th. Any questions about that? We're glad to see that one. Item number three is ordinance 2021-44, an ordinance to rezone 12 acres from R1 to PD 0.92 district for the property located north of Boyd Mill Avenue and west of Glass Lane at 600 Boyd Mill Avenue, the historic Magnolia Hall PUD subdivision. Joey, you going to take that?
I will. Thank you. And for the new alderman-elect, I'm Joey Bryan. I'm a principal planner in the current planning division here at the city. And I guess you'll be seeing a lot of me as we present the various development projects that come through. So looking forward to working with all of you. And Alderman Martin, it's been a pleasure to work with you. So I just wanted to say that as well. So this is for the Magnolia Hall PUD subdivision. It's going to be located, if you're familiar with the Magnolia Hall estate out on Highway 96 West. It's the old Italianate mansion built a long time ago. So this is for the rezoning and the rezoning to plan district. That's good to know, yeah. This is the plan district is to accommodate any sort of planned unit development or development plan that comes through. It's a special zoning for proposed entitlements with the specific developments. And this, for any rezoning, we look to our Envision Franklin land use plan, which kind of has a 20-year scope of how we see the city growing and the specific uses within certain areas. And we, with the Envision Franklin, there are different design concepts. And for this particular property, this is in the conservation design concept, which recommends a preservation of 50% open space. So the plan as proposed does meet the plan district with the recommendations of Envision Franklin. Staff recommends approval, as does the Planning Commission.
Questions, comments? Go ahead, Alderman Barnhill.
This is the entire piece of property, right? I was, because I was thinking it was more than 12 acres there, but that's all there is, 12.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
151. Thank you again. A resolution. I'm not used to this. We haven't sat on the floor for ages. A resolution approving a development plan for historic Magnolia Hall PUD subdivision with 5 modification of development standards, sidewalks, retaining walls for the property located north of Boyd Mill Avenue and west of Glass Lane at 600 Boyd Mill Avenue. Established public hearing for December the 14th, 2021.
Thank you. This is for the specific development plan where we get into more site details about the specific development project or the planned unit developments. So in total, the applicant is proposing 11 residential lots. That's including the historic Magnolia Hall estate. And you can see the diagram there on the screens. It is in the conservation subdivision of Envision Franklin. And with certain areas, we do give special consideration within Envision Franklin, including Magnolia Hall. And Envision Franklin states that the historic home and existing view shows that the property should be preserved. Limited clustered single-family infill may be appropriate if the historic estates and surrounding buildings are integrated and transition should be provided to the historic buildings. And it should make those historic buildings a prominent feature of any development. So the plan as proposed does meet the 50% open space recommended by Envision Franklin, as well as maintaining Magnolia Hall as the focus of the development. With planned unit developments or development plans, the applicant can request modifications from our development standards where they propose their own standards. There are 5 such requests with this plan. The first 3 modifications are very similar. They are requesting to not require external sidewalks or exterior sidewalks along the exterior perimeter of the development. We have a sidewalk exhibit as one of our exhibits, if you can pull that up when you get a chance. So they have to, yes, that's it. So they have to request removal of exterior sidewalks based on location on the property. So there are 3 locations, first along Highway 96 West, along Glass Lane, and along Boyd Mill Avenue that the applicant is requesting to not require external sidewalks. Our planning and regulation documents really promote pedestrian walkability. So we do require that all new developments require sidewalks, both internally and externally, to connect the various areas of the city together. And the City of Franklin periodically receives requests to construct sidewalks in existing neighborhoods where a sidewalk was not previously requested. Generally, sidewalk gap projects are much more expensive to construct than if they were constructed at the time of the development, so that's why we require them up front. So staff does recommend denial of modification of standards 1 through 3 for the external sidewalk removal. BOMA, Planning Commission, did recommend approval of these modifications, but that the developer pay $19 per square foot for future sidewalk gap projects. And Paul, do you want to go ahead and take it over from here?
Yes, and good evening and welcome, Alderman-elect. I'm Paul Holzen, the engineering director. Look forward to getting to know you and working with you as we move forward. One thing I wanted to highlight, as Joey stated, is that we generally will always require sidewalk with new development. Over the last few years, we've spent, and I've not done a comprehensive total of this, but around $9 million filling in gap sidewalk projects. On Highway 96, we built a multi-use trail. We have one under construction right now. We built a sidewalk on 96 East recently. We just recently filled in gap sidewalks in Fieldstone Farms Parkway. The other projects our street department took on, I don't have that cost, include South Royal Oaks Boulevard sidewalk gap project, Forest Crossing Boulevard Sidewalk Gap Project, Oak Meadow, Carruthers Parkway, the Conference Center Gap Sidewalk Project, and you get the message that we're delivering. These projects, filling in gap sidewalks, take up a significant amount of time. They're extremely expensive. We have to buy right away. We have to relocate utilities. They're much easier to do on the front end with development. And in this case, there are multiple schools, with Franklin Special School District being right there. There's multiple parks. Our recommendation is that they go in. As Joey stated, that the Planning Commission did not require it. They recommended paying the fee in lieu of. Staff is still of the opinion that these sidewalks should go in. Outside of traffic, it's probably the next biggest request we hear and get from our citizens is to try to install sidewalks, and they're extremely difficult and extremely time-consuming along some of these major roadways.
Go ahead, Alderman Blanton, and I'll go with Alderman Martin after that.
So I'm somewhat familiar with this property. High school friend grew up there. But so a couple of questions. There's some accessory buildings. Like, there's one on this development plan that looks like it's disappeared. And I know there's a, and it's showing here the side, it's not a, it wasn't a residence, but Hooper made it a residence. It lived right there. What will stay, and is it considered historic? Are some of the buildings on the outside, I know there's one on Culberson that sits there. It was more like a garage that held like equipment. I don't know that it was built when the house was built. And then the second thing is, if memory serves, on Glass Lane, there's a rock wall that goes a significant amount of that property, and putting a sidewalk there, that rock wall is pretty close to the to Glass Lane. So I would be concerned about sidewalk right there. And those residents on Glass Lane, there's probably maybe four homes that are built there. So I could see making sure that there's sidewalk, but I'm concerned about the historic wall.
I can say that I hadn't studied it personally in detail, but our team did look at it. They did see that the sidewalks were all feasible and could be implemented with development. We could certainly go back and take a look at those rock wall features and dig into that a little bit more if you'd like.
Yeah, on the west side, it's the old plank fence that's painted, but on Glass Lane, it's a significant wall. So,
and to answer your first question, it's my understanding that it's their intention to preserve as much of the property as possible. If you've worked with Mr. Butler before, you know he's very attuned to preserving as much as they can. He's also willing to do the necessary improvements to the pond that currently is along 96.
Go ahead, Alderman Martin.
No one wants sidewalks more than I. But in this case, if the Planning Commission recommends approving the modifications of standards to do without, I would make a request that you take that money and finish Lewisburg Avenue.
That's a parting shot, Alderman Martin. Way to go.
If we could build Lewisburg Avenue sidewalks for that cheap, we'd do it.
Alderman Barnhill, go ahead.
Yeah, you're getting the multi-use trail on the other side of 96. So you're asking for the sidewalk on the opposite side. You've got a sidewalk on Boyd Mill on the other side from the side that you're asking for. And I'm not sure if you did that. I'm not sure where Glass Lane connects to or goes to. So and I'd be more interested, not necessarily where it's going, but how much we're talking about. If it's 19, what was it, $19 a
square foot?
Square foot. Mm-hmm. What did that calculate out to be?
I did not calculate that before the meeting, but we will have that number for you.
Do that, and because I'm somewhat inclined to take the money and use it wherever we need to use it, maybe. Not necessarily.
I've already asked for it.
Yeah, but you're not going to be here in a couple hours.
He's taking over your territory.
So let's look at that from that standpoint. But I would say that you've got them on both ends, and you've got a real sidewalk on the other side on 96, if and when it gets completed. Yeah. And you've got one on Boyd Mill there, too. So I was just trying to think they come out, you've got them in, you've got them inside the area where the park is there also. So look at that closely and see what we can do on that.
One of the things I think we also heard at Planning Commission was about the constructability of that portion. Do you all want to weigh in on that?
We'll take another look at it, but I talked to our team. They felt that it was all very feasible to do with the development. It'll be very hard to do after the development, but they have the ability where they don't have to go get easements on other properties. So that was what I was told. I can certainly dig into it with them and make sure that it is all very feasible.
Okay.
Alderman Peterson, go ahead.
Alderman Peterson, go ahead.
Of course, I was there for the Planning Commission meeting whenever this was discussed, and there were quite a number of people from either some right in the area, but others that were just concerned about the historic aspect of this. But let me say, if you go out there and look at where this, the boundary there on Highway 96 West, it goes down 10 or more feet just right there. Yeah. I mean, and also, as was already stated, there's going to be a very, very nice wide sidewalk. That's right, on the other side of this. And so, as I say, it you know, looking at that, you can't, you know, where you're looking, I mean, where it is right now, there is no way to put that right next to the road. And as I say, if you go any further on to their property, this property here, it just goes right down. And also, if you're looking at that kind of upper corner there, it's really, really, that you know, if you look at the contours there, they are terrible from there going up for at least, I don't know, 10, 20 feet or more and everything. So it's really not going to be really convenient. And I saw one place where they were talking about maybe trying to do something, you know, that was not right there on the street itself. But that also, the lake there is very, very close there. So it's really, I mean, if you go out there and actually look at it and walk it, I mean, I didn't walk it, but I did drive around there several times. It's not going to be very easy to do this. But let me go on, and I have some more to say. And as also, as Alderman Barnhill said, on Boyd Mill, there's no sidewalk from here all the way down to 11th or wherever it is on that side of the street. But on the other side of the street, there is a sidewalk all the way down. And had someone who's...
Like your sidewalk, you have to cross the road to get to
that. That's right. And also, on the other part, well, let's see, I guess got on the bottom there. I guess it would really be on the western part of it. Once you get out, I mean, I don't know whether it's on Culberson or whether it's on where Boyd Mill comes back again there and everything. There's a very nice sidewalk all the way up to where Boyd Mill hits, you know, there, I mean, there's a traffic signal there. So, you know, if you had a crossing for the school, and, you know, you could maybe even have something like, you know, the little pedestrian crossing there and everything, and so anybody could get to the other side. So, as I say, a number of people spoke about this, but also we were saying that really there are some options there that would fit in with what's already there or what's coming on the other side of 96 West too.
One thing I would just add to is the developer is proposing to rehab the lake. So if you were to ask us to come back in the future and try to put this sidewalk in, it would be extremely difficult because of the contours that you just mentioned. However, with them rehabbing the lake, now would be the time to do the grading that you need to do to put it in. Now, we'll respect whatever decision you make. You want to take the money, we can absolutely go that route and do that. But just understand, extremely difficult to do this after the development is the point.
before we get to the place where we're voting on this, you know, at another meeting, please give us the contours there. I mean, show us where, I mean, because that thing just goes right down, right on that corner there. And as I say, please have those and have them so that we can look at them, because that is not easy.
And maybe some photos of the rock wall.
Yeah.
Vice Mayor?
I think that I have some issues here with somebody trying to do something totally out of the box and give us some real uniqueness here and yet trying to hold to city standards. Get that all day long that we have city standards, but this is out of the box, and I really want to see this keep and retain the rural character that Bernie Butler is trying to do here. And so I'm not in favor of these internal sidewalks because this is an internal community which will be easy to move around in and everything. And some of the things he proposed in here was trying to keep that rural feel that we all are losing. And we're talking about this all the time. How do we keep, you know, not do everything so urban or so dense or whatever? And here he's bringing us a great plan. And so I'm not sure these sidewalks really make sense. And I think next week or 2 weeks from now, when we have the public hearing, I think we're going to hear from a lot of neighbors out there that don't want these sidewalks around that area. Internally, I can't support the sidewalks internally. I see what he's trying to do. I've seen the development at our joint meeting, and I like that. And I think that that is bringing us something unique for a unique piece of property that's historic. So I'm with Ann. I'd like to see the contours of that because I think it's really important that we look at that. To me, it just doesn't make sense around 96 because we've got that other one across the street. So usually we put one on one side of the street and not the other sometimes when we're trying to build sidewalks like this. So I'll be interested in, I'll also be interested to hear some of the neighbors when they come in for the public hearing.
Alderman-elect Baggett.
I guess I'll kick this off then. So as I look at this, as a father who uses a double-wide stroller regularly on sidewalks in the city, access, you know, down here at the, I guess, what direction is this? This is the west side. There, it looks like to be a little alleyway out to Boyd Mill, connecting, that is out of the view of the historic structure, but could connect into that existing sidewalk on Boyd Mill. That could connect then the neighborhood to the existing sidewalk infrastructure that already exists. If we're going to do away with that internally, or if that is something that the board's considering, having some access, whether that be inside or outside of the development, I don't know what the dimensions are, if it can even, I don't want to mess with the lot widths necessarily, but just making it easy to connect to that sidewalk, that may be too much, but getting to the existing structure would be helpful for those residents, and I don't know that the exterior necessarily accomplishes that at this point. But and I would echo the north side is very problematic. But yeah, just a thought there. There's already existing infrastructure there, the sidewalks to the west. That we could connect to, if you could connect to those, use some of those funds to connect to that more easily.
In reference to that, though, that means he has to cross somebody else's property, happens to be the city's, to get to that, right? I've got mine right here. Yeah, isn't that?
Yes, sir.
So you're not. So it's not. You don't. Yeah. You couldn't require him to do that. With him having to negotiate a requirement to come to the city, to come across the city's property to connect to that. So, I mean, we can get out and, I guess, sell the property to him, donate the property to him, whatever you want to do, somewhere or another way. But you're just looking at that piece of property right there is what you're looking at.
Go ahead, Alderman Berger, you had a question.
I just have a question. That internal sidewalk that he wants, or that doesn't want to put in there, I understand if he does put that in there, we lose those beautiful trees. Because we talked about that at the joint workshop, and that was one of the problems.
That did come up at Planning Commission, yeah. And Assistant Director of Engineering Jimmy Wiseman did say that there is some flexibility about where the sidewalk can go to help preserve the tree row to the front of the house.
All right, and also, it's $19 a square foot, so wouldn't we just be requiring him to pay what sidewalks he wouldn't put in that were required?
Yes.
Because to me that's an awful lot that's being, well, we'll talk about that next time. It'll be fine.
Okay. Oh, man, I may weigh in just a little bit. I understand the challenges on 96 West as far as the sidewalk because of the drop-off. On Glass Lane, that's a pretty steep incline going down that hill, and there's a huge dip down there, and I can see some challenges there. But I'm thinking of kids that may live in this neighborhood. I'm thinking about the need for a sidewalk internally. I'm thinking about that sidewalk on Boyd Mill that would connect, and I'd like to see some other connectivity, how that actually connects, a little bigger picture as far as the connectivity goes there. I'm trying to look as you go toward the park there, Jim Oren Park. Is there some sidewalk opportunity there?
And I apologize for not having that. What we can do for the next meeting is put together a sidewalk exhibit that's further zoomed out, and you can see what benefit or lack of benefit they provide and make your own.
Because I can see, you know, I would worry about a kid that walks out of the development and then he's crossing Boyd Mill. Boyd Mill's got quite a bit of traffic on it now because it's kind of a cut through for a lot of people. So, you know, if they don't have to cross the street and they can get on the sidewalk, that's good. The other thing is, I looked through my notes today and I couldn't find it, but some of the road standards, I understand he wants a different type of road surface and a different type of concrete shoulder to that road. And I don't have any problem with a shoulder, but I have great concern about a road that the city is going to own and what is our upkeep obligation on that in the future. I just keep thinking about Eastern Flank and Harlandsdale, where we saved a bunch of money, but it ended up costing us a bunch of money because it was a lousy road. So I'm concerned about that. And I understand that Mr. Butler's trying to get a certain aesthetic feel and look to it. But also I'm concerned about the next board or the board after that having to pony up money to fix something that may not be totally standard for the city.
Just to address that concern, I do know that his street pavement section is complying with city standards, and I do know that our Public Works and Engineering Department is accepting of the thickness of it for the long-term maintenance. There are two other issues of which he has to go to the appeals board to get resolved prior to this coming back to the board, which may be adding to some of the confusion, and that'll happen. Either he'll accept our conditions of approval or he'll go through that appeal process prior to going forward to the full board. But the actual thickness and material, I do know our Public Works and engineering team is in agreement with what he's proposing.
What is he appealing?
He's appealing the width of the roadway, and it's up to him. He may choose to appeal the width of the roadway, and he may choose to appeal the stream buffering that's been proposed. So the two items that are still unresolved.
I'm sorry, Ms. Clayton, go ahead.
Excuse me, Mayor, I didn't mean to, just to bring clarification, since good evening, I'm Elisa Clayton, Parks Director. Since my home, my second home is located right across the street.
Across the street.
Just to share is, on Culberson Avenue, you have sidewalks on both sides as you come into the park, and leads all the way down to Petway. As a Parks Director, as we talked about connectivity, being able that a resident, whatever's the decisions you bring the sidewalks out of the subdivision, but once you get to the main entrance, if there's a way to connect pedestrians safely to an existing sidewalk on Culberson, then that might be something to take it at least call to take a look at. The other entrance that was mentioned tonight is a maintenance entrance that's been there, is city property. It currently is broken gravel to asphalt. That would have to be something that is discussed, whether that needs to come through as a connection. From a park standpoint, we would not want this as a drive by any means. but having a pedestrian connection, mm-hmm. we do have those kind of connections through Claremont and other areas mm-hmm. into a park. So that might be something we take a look if you, if the desire is to take funding from the development, then maybe that is a piece that can be connected and done correctly under engineering standards. Thank you for letting me speak to that.
Mayor, just
go ahead, one on here.
The comment that you made when from Board Mill, right there at the corner of Claiborne, what is it, Culberson. It probably connects. Now, I'm just by memory. What you know, what you're talking about. I don't think it would be anything to connect to that corner down there where
there's sidewalk there.
Right. Yeah. Sidewalk there. Mm-hmm. There. And you're talking about you want sidewalk on Boyd Mill coming out. I don't disagree with that. I think that would be appropriate.
So it sounds like it would be helpful for us to provide some more.
I think so.
Graphics and description of the sidewalk situation. I'd really like to know what he's going to do on the width of the road, because quite frankly, narrowing the road and not requiring a sidewalk within where the folks live would really make me think twice about that. So maybe we can get some clarity in terms of that aspect and just see how those all those pieces fit together for you.
Alderman-elect Potts.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, along your same concerns as you were talking about children and pedestrians and the schools, I know that there is at that intersection that you were referencing in the mornings and in the afternoon, I'm all but sure in the afternoons, I know for sure in the mornings, at the intersection of Glass and N96, where there is a crossing guard there that helps with children to get across right now. I would also be interested to see there as well as at this new intersection there at Culberson and 96, if the school has plans or if the Franklin Police Department has plans to have any additional crossing guards there as well, or if they have any idea of what the child traffic might be in that area.
You're talking about at Glass and 96.
That was one of them. Mm-hmm. There is a crossing guard there.
There is a crossing guard there now.
Correct. Yes.
And that there is a pedestrian signal at the other end.
Yes.
Yes.
Alderman Peterson is talking about that is an activated mm-hmm. pedestrian crossing. And we can look at it.
Mr. Mayor, if
I say the last one, go ahead, Alderman Peterson.
Thank you. Well, for a person who lives in a subdivision that does not have curb and gutter, and it's also kind of, if you want to say it, a dead end, you know, it really, when people walk out in the street, you know, and so I'm thinking about that little interior road there. You know, there's going to be very little traffic on that. I can't see anybody going in there to try to cut across anything. I mean, it doesn't go. You know, it doesn't cut across. So really, the walkability inside there really would not require a sidewalk. As I say, we don't have sidewalks. As I say, we don't even have curb and gutter. We don't have sidewalks, and we walk there every day, you know, and you can walk out in the street because there's no traffic.
Mm-hmm. Okay, item 5, which is the Parkland Impact Fee Agreement for this property. Anybody got a question about that? If you want to tell us about it very quickly.
I don't mind at all. So as Joey and Paul has already shared, there's 10 homes in here. Parkland Impact Fees are an assessment to the development to pay for their proportionate share of the impact they have on the park system. And so this particular contract brings forth an impact fee that's just fees only. So it'd be a total impact fee of $43,040. Happy to answer any questions you may have.
Total.
It's
just for Parkland.
It's 10 homes. It's $4,304 per home.
Oh. Well, now that we've talked about the Parkland impact fee, I'm going to have to back up because we skipped two of the modification of standards. So, Joey, we got carried away walking on the sidewalk.
Very exciting.
So, give us the other two.
It's all very exciting. So MOS number four is very similar. It's for removal of internal sidewalks. Staff is recommending approval with the condition that they install essentially half of the internal sidewalks. It starts at the kind of the lower half of the cul-de-sac and extends all the way down to Boyd Mill Avenue. And we did discuss the location in relation to the historic tree row. And the exhibit you see there is not where the sidewalk necessarily has to go, just more of an exhibit of where it could go. So staff is recommending that these only half of the internal sidewalks be constructed. Planning Commission did recommend approval of removing all internal sidewalks with the condition that the applicant pay $19 per square foot towards the fees in lieu for future sidewalk gap projects. And the fifth modification is for location of a retaining wall within 5 feet of the public right-of-way. And staff and Planning Commission recommended approval of that due to the location of the pond and the kind of other limitations of the property. So happy to answer any questions with those.
Is that the green?
The green is a proposed trailway. And so we wanted to just show that the sidewalk along Glass Lane could, in theory, tie into the proposed trail along that side of the pond and meet the requirements of having a sidewalk along Glass Lane.
Where's the rock wall?
The rock wall is on the lower side of the pond, on the western side, close to where the curve is into the cul-de-sac. So it's within 5 feet of the internal right-of-way.
Now, can we go to six? Okay. Which is ordinance
2021-46. That's a good job. Thanks, Eric. Button pusher. Which is to rezone 6.87 acres from Regional Commerce to RC6 District to PD 39.44 per 8. 1,595 district for the property located north of Cool Springs Boulevard and east of Mackhatcher Parkway at 151 Cool Springs Boulevard.
Thank you. This is similar to the previous rezoning request to a planned district to accommodate the Haven at Cool Springs planned unit development. And with this development, they are proposing 297 multifamily residential units as well as 8,595 square feet of commercial space. The Envision Franklin plan places this property in the regional commerce design concept, and new development within regional commerce contain high intensity activity centers that attract large numbers of people and employers from both within and outside of the city, and that these areas include major employment and revenue generators that are valuable community resources. New development should have integrated designs with coordinated access, amenities, and cohesive architecture that fits with the context of the corridor. So what they've proposed with this rezoning is consistent with Envision Franklin, and staff and Planning Commission recommend approval.
More apartments.
Vice Mayor said more apartments. Item 7 was just Resolution 2021-154, resolution approving a development plan for Haven at Cool Springs PUD subdivision for the property located that we're just talking about. So
yes.
Go ahead, Joy.
So again, it's for 297 multifamily residential units as well as 8,595 square feet of commercial space, and the commercial space would be located on the ground floor. Within regional commerce, multifamily apartments, or could be condos, is permitted as a use, so it is supported by both Envision Franklin and the zoning ordinance. So with new multifamily residential is encouraged with regional commerce to create lively, walkable neighborhoods near restaurants, shops, grocery stores, and workplaces. First floors are encouraged to have active commercial spaces, including retail, restaurants, leasing offices, and other amenities. Also, ground floor units should also have external entrances so they can also utilize the pedestrian access as well. So staff recommends approval with conditions, as does Planning Commission. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Go ahead, Alderman Barnhill.
Do you want do you want to reference the road alignment and what it does to the project next to it and coming down and going to the signalized intersection? I mean, we've been looking at that for years, and
I can say that our engineering department has reviewed this, and it does currently meets
our needs.
Yes,
it's what we want to do.
Yes.
Okay.
And it does provide cross access connectivity
right.
as well.
And we'll close one access off, a non-signalized intersection, and move it to a signalized intersection, and it'll connect both this property and the one closest to Mac Hatcher then.
Yes, I believe so.
Okay.
Wind cross.
For the Alderman-elect, do you understand what we're talking about?
We need to see a better picture there.
That's where
because
I'm going.
You can see where.
So thank you. You're talking Wind Cross Boulevard.
Mr. Mayor, am I recognized?
Go ahead. You're recognized.
Because I use the green cleaners across the street, and it is terrible. Am I hearing that existing is going to be shut off, or the existing right in, right out? Or yeah, explain the traffic flow, if you don't
mind.
Come on
up. We've got the answer,
I get the signalized where it exists, but...
Good evening. I'm Ryan McMaster with Kimley Horn, and the existing access point is proposed to be converted to a right-in, right-out only. So there'll be no left-hand movements leaving the existing development, and there'll be no left-hand movements turning in.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Smart.
Yeah, I think what Alderman Peterson is wanting to see is how it comes off Cool Springs, how it aligns with, what is that, Wingate?
Wind Cross.
That's where the light will be.
And make sure everybody understands that. Come on up. Yeah, we want to activate all the consultants here tonight.
That's right.
Yeah.
You've got it. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Dwight Kaiser. I'm a landscape architect, the founder of Kaiser Vogren Design, and a proud resident of Ward 2. Thank you. I believe we have whoever's controlling the video or the has a there's a rendering site plan rendering that indicates the street sections that you're talking about. We've been working on this project for roughly since 2014. It's and always we've been trying to fix out this cross-access easement because, as you know, when the MOB was originally approved, it was a little bit too close to the Mac Hatcher intersection. If you can see this, there is an alignment with Windcross Court where there is an existing light, and that would be updated.
Yeah.
There's indication of the curve that comes in across both faces of both projects and then connects into the existing private access drive, which will give much better traffic handling capabilities, obviously, than what we're working with now. There's also a number of utilities that are going in there, including a 24-inch water main that will soon be installed, so there's a lot of work. And the site, it sits about 65 feet from top to bottom as it drops off. This project uses a parking deck to actually fill the hole, so there is no exterior parking. Everything's under the six-story building that was proposed.
Everybody clear now?
Is that part two or part three of our thing?
Mayor Moore, I'm the owner of the adjacent property where the access goes through. Is it okay if I make
sure, it come on up.
So, these guys next door, we've all been, Eric Powers with the Innovations Group, Architects Developers, and we are the owners of the property next door to this where the access happens at the traffic light. So, all of these property owners, obviously we've been working diligently with you guys for many years trying to figure out how to solve the logistics of this corridor, if you will, down through here. And so it's a lot to it. I think the, and we certainly understand the logistics and the need to work the access across our property to get to the traffic light, and we're more than willing to try to work together to make that happen. I am concerned about the logistics of how the impact of the traffic, that much traffic coming through. I think we just have to consider that correctly and make sure the impact of that traffic as it comes across my property doesn't unduly burden our property to the what all that's going to be. So those are things that will need to get worked out as we continue to work through this. But I just think it's something that we all need to consider. It is a very difficult logistical challenge as to the properties and how they connect, and we recognize that. And certainly these guys that are working on the site next door, absolutely, too. So I just wanted to make that point that we do need to consider that, especially if we're going to go to 297 units next door. I think multifamily is a great use for this zone. So I do agree with that, but just making sure we work out the impact of that is all I would want to recognize. So.
Any other questions or comments? Can we move on to the parkland dedication fee?
Say that there is a flood back in the back of that, but it's not.
It's not being impacted.
Not being impacted at all.
No. Thank you.
Any questions about the parkland impact fee? Go ahead, Alderman.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Not sure that this is on the parkland impact fee, but it's on the comments that the gentleman just made about using his property to be able to loop around to gain access. Are there, and we'll just chalk it up to being new, but are there any plans to open anything up onto Mac Hatcher coming off of those other two buildings right there?
No, we're not able to provide. It's a limited access state route, and that's not really an option for this property owner or really anybody else on Mac Hatcher.
Okay, thank you.
Go ahead, Mr. Girth.
Thank you. Good evening, Alderman and Alderman-elect. I'm Vernon Girth, one of the assistant city administrators, and focus my attention on supporting our great team on growth management, capital projects, historic preservation, but really maintaining the quality of life in our community that we've come to enjoy. In this particular property, you see there's three property owners. One that's not represented here is Jason Ritson and his partner that has the corner property in the existing medical building. We've worked for many years, as they have said, to try to get a connection across those properties that provide adequate access without overly impacting Cool Springs Boulevard anymore. With the new northwest section of Mac Hatcher opening up, it's anticipated there'll be more vehicular traffic on Cool Springs Boulevard, and we'll find that out in the next couple months, of course. But the point of me coming up today is that when we work with development professionals like Mr. Powers, Jason Ritson, Dwight, and Ryan McMaster and their clients, we expect this level of cooperation to ensure we're doing the right thing for the community as well as the property owners. So I compliment them too in working through these details. It's taken a while. Thank you.
Everybody good with the parkland impact fee? And thanks for those comments, Mr. Girth. How about number 9? City of Franklin contract 2021-0283, a professional services agreement with Los Design for design services for Liberty Park expansion, the lump sum amount of $359,000.
So good evening again. So engineering assists parks in the management of a lot of the parks capital projects, but the Parks Department, through a lot of public outreach and involvement, really set the vision for these. And so back in early 2020, BOMA moved forward with a professional services agreement with Lowe's Design to update the Liberty Park Master Plan. And now we're at a point where we're ready to move forward with that initial phase of design, ultimately to get to a construction project. And so Lowe's will be moving forward with the tennis courts, the pickleball facility, main restroom, playground addition, open air farmers market, the batting cages, mountain bike trails, some seating enhancements, and there'll be other site improvements. Lisa's up here, the master plan. We made sure we had a copy of the latest master plan just in case y'all had any questions or concerns.
This will be done in phases as we're utilizing parkland impact fees in this particular quadrant, and so we're very fortunate to have that this is the quadrant that receives the most development. So, but this will be completed in phases. So the first phase you'll see of a good bit. Liberty Park was constructed in 2003 and was opened then, and so it's a lot of travel baseball, and our Franklin Baseball Club utilizes it, but we also have a dog park and the disc golf course already on site, and McKay's Mill, and those residents utilize this park. So it's 85 acres, and so we're excited about this new development through here. Thank you.
Just as a point of reference, almost all of our parks have some level of a master plan that we're constantly getting feedback from the community and updating, and is really just our long-range guide.
Does this do away with any current amenities that are currently provided, or is this just adding?
This is adding, yeah. Absolutely.
And this is reflective of feedback we got from the board probably 6-7 months ago related to this plan. So
absolutely,
this is following through on that as well.
And can we say, I think now it's saying that what we're looking at is like 14.7 million. But on our CIP, it only shows like 5.4 million. So that's what we
have.
That's
the phasing. Mm-hmm. So the phasing, yes, ma'am. So thank you for bringing that up. So as the memo suggested, there's quite a few, but what's being included in here is a multi-purpose field to where it can be utilized by citizens, it can be utilized for flag football or cricket or anything as such. We also have some additional, we needed some ADA accessibility to our existing batting cages that's on site. We will also have a cricket batting cage. We will have mountain biking trail system, farmer's market, as well as a pavilion. And what was asked of Alderman Smeedy, he's not around the table right now, is for us to take a look at basketball or some type of multi-purpose, because we only have the basketball court at Jim Warren. So we've included that in that particular one. The total is over 14 million. So there's a lot. It's included in the master plan. So we're going to stay within the budget of what's approved in the CIP. But these are the first phase of projects to come through. So hopefully as parkland generates in this quadrant, then the next phase will come as the money comes along.
So you don't have a time frame. You have a money frame.
We have a money frame.
It's a new term.
It's a new term. But it will be in a short period of time.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So yes. Thank you. So we're excited about this. Absolutely.
Okay, item 10, which is Amendment 7 to the TDOT Agreement number 110291, City of Franklin Contract 2011-0129 for the Franklin ITS Extension and the Adaptive Signal Control. Please finish that.
So let me introduce Adam Mosier. He's our city traffic engineer. He's probably one of the best traffic engineers across the state of Tennessee. We actually hired him as a consultant to do this project, and then we've been fortunate enough and blessed to have him come join our team. So we were very, very lucky to have Adam. So there's two, essentially what this is, this agreement with TDOT is simply extending the completion date another year. That's all we're doing here. But to give a brief overview of the two projects, one involves 19 signals in the Cool Springs area where Adam is working to install an adaptive system, and the other one is ITS equipment, and I'll let Adam give a brief overview of both. And really what it is we have fiber optics that connect all of our signals. They're able to communicate with it and change signal timing on the fly from the Traffic Operations Center. So Adam, if you don't mind, just give a brief overview of both projects to introduce our new alderman to it.
So yeah, I'm Adam Mosier, the traffic engineer. I'm not definitely as good as Paul tells me I am, but I have a constant target on my back.
Yeah, everybody get your number.
Everybody's going to have my number again. There are 19 intersections on Cool Springs Boulevard and Mallory Lane from basically the Costco Seaboard down to Cool Springs on Mallory, and then from Mac Hatcher over to Carruthers. They operate on what's called an adaptive signal system, which measures traffic in real time and makes adjustments in real time. So the green lights will change based on volumes. It's a pretty advanced system, and it is done. It is working. It's been working since about June or July this summer. We do make constant tweaks to it. We are in a learning process because it's pretty advanced. So that's almost done. In fact, we'll have a before and after report on conditions before we installed it and conditions after we installed it, hopefully by the end of the year. As far as this particular extension goes, this is mostly for extension of our cameras, our traffic cameras that we use in the traffic operations center. So that piece, there's a parent project. The parent project is actually this piece, which is the smaller of the two projects, believe it or not. And the child project was the adaptive signal system under this project number. So with TDOT, it is all grant funds, 80-20, 80% federal, 20% local. And so this is just a time extension. This portion is taking us a little while. So that's why we got the extra year.
And not many communities in Tennessee have this. I think Mount Juliet maybe has either Mount Juliet or Lebanon has one area, but I'm sure there are others. Nashville doesn't have it.
They don't.
They have total, I'm sorry, I shouldn't say that, total malfunction of all their signals. But
Mount
we're pretty
Juliet,
far ahead as far as signal control.
Yep.
Do we have a question? Do you have, I know we don't have 96 intersection at 65 on here. Once that road, that four-lane road is done, is TDOT going to work with us? Are we going to redo our signals there? Because I constantly get calls about that from Ed Curd through the signal. It's just mind-boggling because you can't get them. You can just start up and then stop, start up and then stop. So how's that going to, I know it's not in here.
Right. So that is covered under a CMAQ grant that we got a couple years ago. And we are finishing design with that.
Okay.
We just advertised a request for a proposal for the technical pieces of that technology, which is software. And so that is a separate project. There's 13 intersections along State Route 96 East in that project, basically from Eddy Lane all the way to Arno.
Okay.
So that is under a separate project that's in CMAQ grant.
And they shouldn't mess with that and do that until we've got that four lane open, because that's going to change everything. So how's that going to work?
The good thing about this technology is it just learns as we go. So yes, you can put it in and we'll be fine. Yeah, it'll actually help us tweak it. That's what that system is.
Okay, because I knew we had something in the works, but I didn't know where in the heck it was.
That's right. Okay. And it does have connected vehicle components. We're going to come back in, I guess, January after the first of the year and kind of talk about our traffic technology so you guys are all up to date on what we're doing in the city. So,
but it really is a great way to make the infrastructure we have work as efficiently as possible. We all know adding asphalt takes a lot of time and a lot of money, and we're still going to be doing a lot of that, but this helps us maximize the efficiency of what we have so much easier with this kind of technology. And it is pretty unique for a community our size to have this, or any community to have this. So I applaud our team for pursuing it and putting it in place.
For somebody who used to go out 96 East to the interstate every morning, yes, it really helped.
I feel you.
Okay, item 11 is grant water availability for 1200 Old Hillsborough Road. Rapidly approaching Michelle Hatcher. Push your button.
There we go. Good evening. I am Michelle Hatcher. I am the director of the water department. So the first one, this 1200 Old Hillsborough Road. We normally take these availabilities to the Capital Investment Committee. This one is a little bit of a time sensitivity because the last Capital Investment Committee meeting was canceled. That's the reason why normally they're not voted on here, but just to set that precedence. So this is at the intersection of Old Hillsborough Road and Old Hillsborough Road and Hillsborough Road. There's the map, that red outline. It is a mixed-use commercial development that is planned. They're asking for 4 2-inch meters and 1 1-inch meter. This is within our water service area, so up in Grassland. The one thing we like about this project is the applicant has agreed to loop the water line to kind of increase the water circulation in the area, which ultimately increases the water quality. The water department is recommending approval. The applicant is requesting approval. We're obviously recommending approval contingent upon the execution of the availability agreement, which would outline the looping of the water line. We're also recommending approval without the execution of an annexation agreement. And the reason for that is because this is already, we typically do annexation agreements to kind of control growth as we can manage them coming into the city. This is already in Cartwright's Creek sewer area. So it's not going to be changing anytime soon.
And it's outside of your UGB.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, so I wanted to set that precedent so we were clear what we were voting on. So this is on both the work session and then you'll be voting on that tonight because so we can continue them moving forward.
Mayor.
Go ahead, Alderman Barnhill.
Can we ask you to assume some additional responsibilities on this? Huh?
I'm not sure what that means.
You're not sure what that means?
You might want to clarify before you answer that.
They need, and I know they're in the county. Now I know that we have no control over it. But that left turn lane into old Hillsborough Road off of Hillsborough Road or any of those others is backs up traffic forever. They need to do some road improvements on that particular intersection right there where that traffic signal is, where old Hillsborough Road comes in, to make a left-hand turn north, well, it'd be northbound traffic, but doing a west turn lane into old Hillsborough Road. They also need to make one that's southbound onto that, a decel lane turning in to old Hillsborough Road also, since that's on the corner, and that's going to be a pretty significant development. So here comes Mark. Mark is the one that assumes the additional.
And I'm fine with that.
You're fine with that.
I think I'm glad you brought that up. In the back of my mind, seemed like we've seen that at the Transportation Policy Board.
Yeah. And, if we have, lovely.
TDOT is planning on doing an intersection improvement in that area. So
when?
We don't have a date on that, but we have seen some draft plans. So.
Okay.
So
where
is
it right
there,
right?
Just beyond the traffic signal. There is a bridge. North. I think it's just north of the intersection.
Yeah.
Yes.
Go ahead, Alderman Martin.
Can you hold the permission to do this work until that road is fixed?
That's a Tennessee Department of Transportation project.
Until they go to the state and work it out.
I would not recommend you do that.
Hey, if it's so, taken this long for us to get Matt Catcher, think. Don't say anything that you're going to require people to get TDOT to do something before they do anything.
I have some familiarity with this particular project and some of the ways that they've been providing water to some of those properties are pretty archaic. I guess that's a nice way to say it.
Yes,
so
sir.
It's very important to get this done.
Yeah.
And this is partially a medical use in this building,
correct.
And mm-hmm. So it kind of fits into that area.
If I may, sir, I apologize. I didn't introduce myself. I'm Mark Hilty, Assistant City Administrator of Public Works. So
I picked him up on the side of the road.
So do we have to show up at MPO and start haggling them to get this intersection done? Is it helpful? Or who's going to MPO?
I'll be happy to speak with Jonathan about that, but I don't know that we have any influence on
when
they
do
this project.
Well,
We can try.
You go and speak at MPO, you do.
Mm-hmm. You're exactly right. And Jonathan is our TCC representative, and I'm the Transportation Quality Board representative, and we certainly advocate for those projects, and the county's advocated for it also. So.
I want you to go talk to
them. County and
about
city are advocating.
I got another project you can talk to about.
And Michelle is advocating.
And Michelle, yeah.
The one lane.
And she's not picking Mark up on the 7.
That's it.
How about item 12?
I don't know. How about it?
Change order 2 to the City of Franklin contract 2018-0226 with BLD services for cured in place pipelining in an amount not to exceed $479,000 and $300.
So this is a project. We have a sewer main running through south of Matt Catcher, east of Franklin Road. We recently replaced a sewer main from kind of going on the west side of First United Methodist Church to kind of the beginning of this project area. When we were connecting that project to kind of the older infrastructure that was there, we noticed that this line that's in the kind of clouded area is in need of some repair. It's an older line. It's been subject to some corrosion issues. Wanted to move this up in our priority list of kind of repair projects that we do. So we solicited a quote for actual pipe replacement, so full pipe replacement from the contractor that was out there. You can see in the memo, it was close, it was $850,000, so it was very pricey. We need to require, you know, get some temporary construction easements, those types of things. BLD Services has a mainline CIPP lining contract with us. So CIPP lining is cured in place pipe. We take almost like a sock and we invert it into the pipe. As we're pushing it through, it kind of inverts itself and it structurally, we cure it and it structurally creates a new pipe. So it's less invasive. We have to dig a small pit at the manhole, you know, to put it in, and then a small pit to get it all the way to the other side. We've been doing rehab in other areas of the system with this same type of lining, so it's a good fit here because it's a hard area to get to. This is a change order that will allow us to do that because it's on both work session and voting tonight. We're hoping to take advantage of the beautiful dry weather we've had. This area is in the floodplain and it dries out. It's slow to dry out, so we're hoping to kind of get that in place before the winter, when the wet season sets in.
And these services were previously acquired through a procurement process. We're just adding the change order to allow us to do this project. So we competitively bid or sought the service, and this just adds on this project and helps us do it much more efficiently.
Correct, yes.
Go ahead, Alderman Bagley.
Excuse me, since this is Ward 4, and I'm sorry, pardon me is the proximity and time, when was the original, I guess, agreement made? Like, what time frame? How long?
So 2018 was when we initially awarded the contract. So we typically award contracts for 3 years standard, and then we have 2 one-year riders if both parties can agree to the same terms.
It's just coincidental that it is adjacent to the Emmeline Acres property. It's not. That's coincidental. It's not anything to do with that project.
Not related at all.
Okay.
It is actually, as we're doing the other work, this was discovered to need the improvements.
Thank you.
Yeah.
How about City of Franklin contract 2020-0190, a road impact fee reimbursement agreement with Simmons Ridge?
So this agreement essentially updates the road impact fee agreement to reflect kind of the conditions that exist today in working with development. It's a project from a development side that was approved several years ago, and this provides for their ability to access collector road impact fees and looks at the project from that standpoint. Vernon, I'm sure, can add some more details. So, not sure if you're coming up.
Thank you, Eric. Good evening again. Simmons Ridge was approved a number of years ago, but had an amendment about 10 years ago that landed on 408 units. And this development is located on South Carruthers Road on the east side of the interstate. And to date, probably about 200 units have been constructed and or occupied on the development. So they're almost halfway through. When the development came in back for that amendment, there was a condition placed that before the 241st permit was issued, that improvements to South Carruthers Road would be completed. Now, we're coming back to you today, as Eric mentioned, for a couple of reasons. First of all, at the time this project was originally approved, and even when the amendment was approved, the city did not require development impact fee agreements, roads, parks, sewer and water, to travel along with a development plan or a development plan amendment. And Lisa had talked to a couple
that are going to be coming and travel along. That way that you as the Board of Mayor and Aldermen, before rendering a decision, have the whole picture of the development. So we're catching up with this one. Also, since this development had started, and there's a few other ones that we're affording them the opportunity to collect the collector road impact fees that they are now paying in. The city amended the road impact fee ordinance to require developments to pay both arterial road impact fees as well as collector road impact fees. So those developments that are either in the process or getting started, such as Simmons Ridge, on those collector road improvements will allow them to recapture their impact fees. And as the ordinance states, they only can collect or have reimbursed up to the amount that they pay in. If the improvements, which this case is, exceed the road impact fees, they have to pay for those. And they knew that when this was originally developed. So we have the plans approved. They're acquiring some easements yet. This impact fee agreement updates everything that I just said, and we recommend approval. And with that approval, we'll allow them to continue to obtain building permits as long as they have posted sureties and commenced work on site on those improvements. And the reason we're doing that is because since this development happened so many years ago, there have been other developments in the area that have proceeded. Any questions?
Go ahead, Alderman Peterson.
Mr. Mayor, I was thinking about this for some things that we're going to see later on tonight, but I thought it might be important to talk about the collector roads, which are more local roads, and we've got the city divided into four quadrants. They're not the same thing as the wards or anything like that. And so we might have someone talk about where those are, and it makes a difference in collector road fees, but also in parkland fees. They have a similar situation where you can use the money only in those particular areas. And so I don't know whether this is the place to say that or what, but that is an important idea. And there are I was thinking more road fees and everything, and I didn't look at parkland, but there are some of these quadrants that have a lot more money in them right now, because I was thinking quadrant one, which is what, it's 96 east and all the way around to is it Hillsborough or Franklin? What, tell me.
That is a wonderful idea, and to illustrate it, because I wasn't prepared for that.
I know.
We'll bring an illustration back during a work session and explain that further, both how those funds are being used within the quadrant where the development occurs, mm-hmm. and that applies to parkland too, as well as collector road impact fees.
Yeah,
if I may.
Yeah, that's all part of, also included in your capital investment program and financing model, is how you can allocate those dollars. We do have a quadrant map of the parks we could pull up to give you that sense, but we can also share that with you with the latest balance in each of the quadrants, both from a collector impact fee and from the parkland. This is the parkland version of that. That gives you a sense of how we've done it, and we collect those as development happens, and then we allocate it to appropriate projects within those quadrants.
And I know on the roads, quadrant one, which is not exactly this, but similar. Has like $2.3 million, and that is like more than all the rest of the other three put together. So wherever development is happening, then they are paying in on these collector road, you know, and the parks too. But it also means that's where monies need to be spent to build more roads, more parks, things like that.
Let's move on to item 14, which is a procurement award to Monitoring and Management Services LLC of Franklin, Tennessee, in the total estimated amount of $84,420 for sanitary sewer pretreatment program support services, including fats, oils, and grease, commonly called FOG, over a three-year initial term of award for the Water Management Department.
So this was a contract, or I'm sorry, a procurement solicitation that was put out in our normal bid process. We had one respondent, Monitoring and Management Solutions, who's held this previous contract. This was a little bit different than the ones we've done in the past. We're actually reducing their services year by year and moving those to staff that we currently have. So our intent is, to within 5 years to be fully self-sufficient in performing inspections on restaurants for their grease traps. We do those annually. And so this Monitoring and Management Services will be providing that support until we can fully move to our internal staff. Questions?
Go ahead, Vice Mayor.
Is it less expensive to bring that in-house and not contract that out with staff? I mean, in-house with staff, or is it, obviously it is, or we wouldn't be doing it, right?
It is, yes. Yeah. So we have the staff that has the availability to do this. It has been kind
we
of...
We already have staff.
We already have staff that has availability. Yeah, we won't be adding anyone.
Okay.
And it's helpful to have that expertise in-house. Yeah. So it just made sense both from an expertise and cost-effective use of existing staff to do this service.
Okay, so we're not hiring on. Okay.
No. Right.
Let's go to the Williamson County Growth Plan update.
As Emily's coming forward and Andrew, let me just comment. This is a follow-up to a discussion we had a couple meetings ago. So we want to do two things through this discussion. We want to validate what we heard from that board discussion, but we obviously have some new folks coming on board, so we want to get your feedback. I have taken a pretty clear position with Williamson County, their planning staff who's facilitating that I'm not giving them, even though this is only a draft, we're not turning this in until I have our new board saying, yeah, this is good to at least put into the process. This doesn't lock anybody into it, but this starts the discussion, and we want to make sure our board is comfortable with this being put into the process as we start the more formal process next year. So Andrew and Emily can take you through that, and we look forward to more feedback from you, both in terms of how we've modified this based on feedback and whatever else you want to see as we go forward.
Yeah. Thank you, Eric. I appreciate that. My name is Andrew Orr. I'm the Long Range Planning Supervisor.
I'm Emily Wright, the Planning Director.
I've got a few slides, and I'll try and go quickly because I know we're kind of short on time. And Michael, I'll just kind of look at you and nod. The first two slides have maps. The aqua color represents the urban growth boundary that exists today. The yellow represents the city limits. On this particular map, it's the city limit layers from 2004, so 17 years ago, the city looked a little differently. Yeah. It spanned more east to west. As you can see on the next slide, the city has grown significantly along the I-65 corridor, taking into consideration neighborhoods like Water's Edge, Simmons Ridge, Ladd Park, Berry Farms, Stream Valley. So that's been a high growth area, probably the most significant. And then to the northwest, the city has also grown to take in Brownland Farm and the properties across the river to the west where new Mac Hatcher is coming in. So those have been kind of two areas where the city has grown in terms of going into the UGB. The city has not, there are some areas that haven't changed very much that you can see on the map there. And go to the next slide, please. And I found this chart. It's 20 years old. It was put.
I have it.
It was put together in 2000, and the urban growth boundary went into place in 2000, and this is the first time that we've looked at it in any kind of comprehensive way as part of this countywide growth plan update. In terms of this chart, I wanted to point out a couple things. The population. 20 years ago, we were at 42,000 people. Now we're at 83,454. So we've nearly doubled. 20 years ago, the staff also looked at residential acres and commercial industrial acres and then projected those acreage needs for 2020. And they're pretty close. They're on the residential side, we came in 600 acres short, but then on the commercial industrial side, we came in a little high. So the, in terms of total acreage, it lined up pretty well. So we've looked at this, and we'll kind of weigh this as we look to make our 2040 projections. In terms of population, we do anticipate Franklin to continue to grow. I've put two sources on here. One is the University of Tennessee Boyd Center for Research and Economic Research and Business, and that's required by state law in terms of the UGB update to reference their county, and they do it by county, their county projections. And then as part of the development report that our department does annually, we do population projections, and our 2030 projection is 105,000, and then our 2040 is 126,000. So that's based on historical averages, household size, and approvals. That's where we're heading at this point. This map is the initial staff recommendations for revising our urban growth boundary. And it's based off of a number of factors. I think most of you all are familiar with that. In terms of the colors on the map, the green would be areas to be added, to be included into the UGB. The areas in red would be areas to be removed from the current boundary. Based on some factors. You go to the next slide. Based on the feedback we received from the board at the October work session, there is a consensus amongst the board members at that meeting to not give up any territory. So we've taken that into account and revised it. There did seem to be support to expand the UGB in the Goose Creek area, and that, again, that's kind of our high growth area for the next, short, midterm, foreseeable future. So we were keeping that in. The area that's still in red represents the Gentry Farm and the property to the north, and there is a small area kind of outreach that took place with property owners out there, and sewer availability requests were denied for those two properties. So we're still recommending to remove
because they asked
UGB.
For it.
Denied at their request.
Denied at their request, absolutely. At the last meeting, we didn't talk a whole lot in terms of the Southall Road, Carter's Creek Pike area. It's not an area the city anticipates significant growth. The boundaries, in terms of the city, we've grown very little out in that direction over the last 20 years, and we don't foresee significant growth over the next 20 years. There could be some land use type changes when Mac Hatcher is ultimately extended. That project's still a long way off, and we would account for that. I did highlight Southall Farms, which is a county development approved under county standards, and that's sort of in the middle of that area. And I think that is now a barrier to growing beyond and even up Southall Road. So I did want to bring that to everyone's attention if that's an area we want to look at kind of independently. For removal, yes.
And I think it's also related to just how difficult it would be to serve and truly serve. There's topography and other issues out there. And while we heard you on the east and we understand that component, this is a little different because it's so difficult to serve. And as Andrew referenced, there's some other county development that is already moving forward that it may make sense to remove on that basis. So
there's also an enormous amount of environmental constraints for development in the area. So the land use pattern is not likely to be very dense at all per Envision Franklin recommendations if this area were to grow. As you can see on the map, all that green area are predominantly hillsides, areas of significant slopes. So in addition, providing infrastructure through the area is not an easy task either.
Go ahead, Alderman Barnhill.
I still think the comment that you made as far as the extension of Mac Hatcher, and at some time in the future, some point in time, that will be completed. And when you do, I think that will be an area where it grows. And I'm not sure that I understand. I understand the topography, and I understand the hillsides, and I understand. But we've got, at one time, we had water lines through there. Mm-hmm. The old Hillsboro water line that came through there that pumps into that tank that sits there where Carter's Creek Pike and the old Carter's Creek Pike fork. So I agree that it's not feasible. I mean, it's not the most attractive piece of property out through there. But I think that Mac Hatcher, if you had any idea, any notion, Mayor, as to when that's going to be completed, and I think, and I'll just deviate from my speech a little bit. That's the most important road project in Franklin right now. The fourth leg of that. That's the most important road project in Franklin right now. It's not.
Alderman Peterson and I are disagreeing with you. But
well, that's fine. That's fine. You and Alderman Peterson can disagree. That's eight of us mm-hmm. up here. But that's the most important road project in Franklin. It's not on the list. It's not going to be done immediately. But I would look at it before I left it out, because it'll be easier to. It won't be as easy to put back in later. Mm-hmm. What's the most important road project, Mayor?
I think it's the Mac Hatcher from Columbia Avenue to 96.
Okay. The widening of Southeast.
Yeah. You can walk, okay.
We agree on something, all of us. That's good.
Pretty equal.
That's what that is, isn't it?
No, mine is coming from Highway 96 West around to court to TSC, the fourth leg, the part that's not completed. Yeah, that's what
the Southwest extension.
No, they want to widen it.
96 to Columbia.
They want to widen it. They want to widen
the existing Southeast.
Mm-hmm. And it's had some money attributed to it now, which is a good sign, which means it's starting to move. And there is some alignment money that's been spent on the Southwest section, if I remember correctly.
Okay.
Keep going.
The Goose Creek area, because this is an area where we are experiencing growth and we anticipate continued growth, this slide shows properties that are hatched, and those represent property owners who have asked to be removed from the proposed urban growth boundary. They do not want to be included in the new UGB. Most of those property owners are along Long Lane and then down Paytonsville Road towards the end of the basin. The properties on Long Lane are in a separate basin. The Paytonsville Road properties are in the Goose Creek drainage basin. So there are kind of two basins going on. If you go to the next slide, the current city limits are shown. And you can see the existing urban growth boundary in the aqua color. The city has grown outwardly outside of the UGB in this area, so staff feels pretty strongly that we need to extend the UGB. Now, the Long Lane area, if you go to the next slide, because it is in a separate basin that would have had limited sewer access and availability, and based on what the property owner's desires are, we are recommending we trim that back pretty significantly, but staff is at this point continuing to recommend all the properties on Paytonsville Road stay in the UGB. The last large property on the south side of Paytonsville Road, one of the last properties in green, we had some debate on could we just cut the UGB off there, would that be okay? But ultimately we decided to keep the whole part of the basin.
This aligns with the drainage basin, which is one of the principles we've mm-hmm. tried to stick to throughout this review, is to make it match the infrastructure planning, and to keep that basin whole and in the UGB just seems to make sense.
And I would add that if we've learned anything from the last 20 years, what we didn't do in the Goose Creek area was we didn't follow drainage basin lines originally, and we've had multiple property owner requests to annex by referendum in this area. So I do think it's probably the wisest choice to follow the drainage basin where we can. Obviously, a property owner does not have to request annexation and can remain in the county under state law. That is their option. So I don't think that there's a big worry that if we were to leave this in that, you know, we would be limiting their options by any means. I think it would just make sense if there were any ever decisions for those property owners to come into the city.
It really allows us to plan for it. Those property owners can decide. It really gives them more options long term, but this again aligns with the infrastructure planning.
And we talked a little bit about roadways and street networks, and on the last slide you'll see the proposed street network in the Goose Creek area per Connect Franklin, per the major thoroughfare plan. The engineering department provide some cost estimates for these projects, and that's part of the reporting piece that goes along with the growth plan update. With our review of our urban growth boundary, the state statute calls for looking at infrastructure costs and the fiscal impacts of growth in some of these areas or not. So we know that there are going to be some needed roadway projects, the extension of Carruthers, the extension of Goose Creek Bypass, a potential flyover or interstate interchange between 840 and Goose Creek, and Paytonsville Road improvements as well. And this was sort of a primer for the Goose Creek study that we've started and we'll get into in the next several months.
And so now we just want to open it up to all of you to hear your feedback and any thoughts or questions you may have. Keeping in mind as you're thinking about this and things you may want to discuss, we'd love to hear your thoughts, like Alderman Barnhill started here with a discussion about Carter's Creek in the South Hall Road area. If you would like to see that remain in the UGB or if you'd like to see it removed. Also, what your thoughts are about continuing to add the Goose Creek area. We, as staff, would recommend the tailored back version just to try to accommodate some of the property owner requests along Long Lane, since that is a different basin than the Goose Creek basin. And then just any other concerns or questions you may have about other areas.
Vice Mayor, go ahead.
We discussed this pretty extensively last time, and we talked about what to do with the urban growth boundary, and if you talked about, you know, do we remove any of it? There might be a sliver or something around there that makes sense to remove, but normally any removal of an urban growth boundary is usually not a smart idea for a city. Giving up land, especially, let me just give an example. We have East 96. If you're going on that road out towards Wilson Pike, out towards, if you're going to Arrington. Okay, so we have the state putting in a 4-lane, in some places 5-lane. So you know development's going to happen, but then if it happens in the county, it's county standards, and then you're dotting the landscape with more septic. It's an invitation to more sprawl as well. And I think it would be very unwise to take the urban growth take the land out of the urban growth boundary in that area. And the other thing is, just hold it. That doesn't mean we have to develop it at all. That doesn't mean we have to, you know, even consider it. It's just there. We hold that in our urban growth boundary. But who knows what 10, 15, 20 years will bring as far as technology with sewer systems. They're always coming up with new technology and new ways for safety and for health and safety and sewer and other things associated with sewer and alternative systems. So if we had a crystal ball, we could say what does it look like in 10 or 15, 20 years from now? That's why I would not be in favor of removing any area from the urban growth boundary unless, as you said, that one area and there was a sliver of it was very difficult, hard to service at all. And we don't know, and it makes sense to go down to, you know, the Goose Creek area where you've got easily accessible to sewer, to gravity sewer already, and infrastructure right there. And so anything added on is very easy to do in that area. It's conducive to that. I know sometimes it doesn't look so conducive out of East 96, but again, we don't know what technology will bring in the future for that.
Alderman Brown.
I get, and I agree, generally speaking, if we've got the land, we don't want to lose it. My question on the Carter's Creek piece is, you almost kind of got a donut, right? You've got this county developed piece in the middle of Sullivan Farms, and you've got pieces around it, and not to mention all the challenging issues out there. And I won't hold my breath on that part of Mac Hatcher coming anytime. Smart. Yeah, exactly. Let me eat this apple, as my dad would say. But when I think about that area, though, what if it, especially as we think about Envision Franklin and the idea that as you build around other areas, you need to reflect the other neighborhoods in that area, it seems like that would be a very expensive area to develop, just given all that's going on there. You're not going to have high density to offset a lot of that cost or to bring that up, just given the makeup of that space. I guess that's my question is, it seems like a very challenging place for us and a very expensive place for developers and for the city to develop. And if at that point, you know, I guess it doesn't hurt us to keep it in, but at the same time, not quite sure why we would, if at some point it just becomes that much of a challenge for us to do.
So you're speaking exactly what we've been debating internally with staff for many months. So our original staff recommendation did include removing that area for those exact reasons, that the land use pattern will not likely pay for the cost of extending infrastructure. And, you know, as we as staff, we really look at that long-term fiscal sustainability. And when we look at the Goose Creek area, for example, the land use pattern and a lot of the types of land uses that are going to be able to be supported most likely in that area. Envision Franklin has a lot of it in regional commerce, neighborhood mixed use, mixed residential design concepts that are a little more intense than what you might see out South Hall Road area. Those can accommodate, those land uses can help offset the cost of the added infrastructure. So there is a fiscal sustainability component to consider. But as some other aldermen brought up, there is a question of, you know, if we do take it out, when can we get it back if we decide we want it? And those are unknowns. We haven't had this opportunity to look at the urban growth boundary in 20 years. So this is definitely one of those situations where there's not really a right or wrong answer. It's really about what the board prioritizes. And if it's, you know, kind of heading into the future with the idea that we don't have to develop it necessarily, but knowing what the limitations are and what the cost to develop some of these areas are, I think it can help you make wise decisions as you move into the future. But I think that's always something we all need to keep in the back of our mind if we do keep these areas in the UGB.
Alderman Blanton.
I don't know how many years ago it was, but I remember us allowing Thompson Station to, there was a piece of land that was coming up Carter's Creek Pike, so Thompson Station could extend sewer. So to me, my question would be, at what point does Thompson Station, I know they're way far from sewer, bless their hearts, it is a hard battle for them, but I mean, what is the likability of Thompson Station coming through Kennard Springs and coming up to we almost abut? And then if we've given up that property in the UGB and we can connect, I mean, I understand the challenges, but I just think we have all seen the growth. For those of us who've been here for a long time, we never would have imagined the world we live in today.
So I will say that we've worked with Thompson Station, their planning department, as well as all the municipalities in the county and Williamson County. We meet on a every 2-week basis, and we are seeing what a lot of the proposals are. It doesn't, at this point, we're not seeing Thompson Station come up to where our UGB exists today, but what we do need to consider is how state law is written. So just because they don't place it into their UGB does not mean that they could not annex by referendum in the future. So that is something to still consider, that just because it's not shown on a map in the UGB doesn't mean that we won't ever abut each other's city limits.
Well, if we all remember the big golf development mm-hmm. that did not pass, that mm-hmm. was on Coleman Road, mm-hmm. I mean, that came pretty close to fruition, and that's not that far away. So all of that to say, I think if we've got something, our investment, it's not fiscal, but our investment will never be in vain. So I see holding on to that. In the Goose Creek, I agree with keeping those basins separate. And then lastly, It sounds cherry picking, but I had brought up a family that lives on Hillview Lane that wants to remain in the UGB. And in these maps, it's really hard to scroll out, but from what I can tell, that is still encapsulated within the city limits now. So, and it's not just one within property owner, it's mm-hmm. it's like a family who owns multiple acreage.
That's in?
Yep. It is now.
It's We're still. Not making any changes to that area. We can get with you after
we'll
and look at the
that,
specific
but
property, but we're not planning to make, at least per these maps, we don't have
okay,
anything
so
added
I,
or
yeah,
removed
we can
in
do
that
area. Offline,
that'd
it's
be great.
The end of Hillview Line, yeah.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Alderman Potts.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I know we're pressed on time right now, but as I'm looking at the requested to be removed from the potential UGB, this is on Long Lane there in Ward 3, and I just want to, and maybe now is not the time, maybe we have to do it this at the next work session, but I'd like to know more about the 2040 or, you know, 50-year plan on what it would take to get those areas into our UGB if we let them go right now.
And, you know, we're also happy if anyone has some specific areas you'd like to speak about, I'd encourage you to reach out to Andrew Orr as well, and we can definitely provide some additional information on any of these areas if you'd like to have a meeting with Andrew or myself.
Okay, I'd like to go ahead and finish the meeting if it's okay, because there's going to be a lot of changeover effort, and I know that many of you, the new aldermen, may have family, and you want to tend to them, get everybody settled in, if that's okay with everybody. And go ahead, Alderman. Did I not recognize you, Alderman
no,
Martin?
You didn't. I have one last word.
Is your mic on?
One last word.
Your mic on?
Start
is your mic
your
on?
Mic, turn your mic on. Don't
one,
let it be your last word.
One
let
last
it be one
word.
Of many words.
We do not need to develop every single blade of grass in Williamson County. We can have the city of Franklin and have open space. Isn't that what we want? We don't like the density. Why do we have to talk about developing South Hall? You know, of course they've got hills and places that are hard to develop. That's fine, but we could still have it. We don't have to develop it. And I think the residents would love it if we had places that were not developed, period.
10-second yeah. comment.
10-second. Who develops it?
I'm glad you asked. The property is zoned MGA1, so one unit per acre. So if a large tract comes in, requests annexation, and we decline it, it's zoned MGA1, one unit per acre.
But who develops it? No. The developer develops it.
The property owner.
The
developer
owns the
property.
Develops it.
Yes.
And so all of this stuff about how much it's going to cost and all this, the cost of the infrastructure and all of this, we require the developer to put the infrastructure in. Tell us at some point in time when we don't do that. So the cost is irrelevant, I think, to a certain extent. I don't think you need to give up something that you have. And I will tell you, it's been there for 20 years. It really hasn't affected anything negatively that I know of, because I sit on the 1/8 of the board that was looked at South Hall whenever we looked at the urban growth boundaries in 2002 or 3 once. So it's there. Leave it. It's not going anyplace. Margaret's right. She didn't want to develop every blade of grass.
I would just respond, but that's definitely something that has worked over time and can continue to work. Where I would just say to something to keep in the back of your mind is, oftentimes if the price of developing and paying for the infrastructure to go in by the developer is not something that really, where the land uses don't match up with that cost, they're going to develop in the county instead, which is okay. But what it does is it fragments how we build out our infrastructure system if somebody nearby wants to develop in the city. Mm-hmm. So it starts to make it very difficult to plan out our growth as a city when you have a county-city pattern.
Wouldn't you want to keep it in for that reason?
Well, that argument can be made as well, yeah.
So
Go ahead. Can I'm going to let Eric. Eric's got the last word.
I can say one thing.
Get out of here.
What I'd like to do, because I'd like to get this into the process if we can. I think we're pretty close to a pretty good consensus with you all. Let's put it on for the 23rd work session as just sort of a follow-up. We won't do a presentation. We'll just say, you've seen it. You see what we have. There's really just these few couple questions left. But it gives you a chance to think about it and also kind of gives us a little bit of a deadline to kind of have that discussion. And if we're comfortable, we'll move it on into the process. Again, it's preliminary. But if you're comfortable with that, we'll put it on the work session in 2 weeks. Thank you.